So, what else?
Brian, I'm a newer coach, but I don't know much. So this Sunday we'll work on adding a little more things to his cleanup with loosening the chest straps and getting his leg straps up so that he can apply, some of the harness maneuvers. Do you have any kind of outline or any kind of thing for me as a coach to help that progression of people to start bringing their slider down behind their head, loosening their chest straps, sliding their leg straps? Is there something that they should do first? Could they do them all on a jump, or should they just start with their slider and then their chest strap? And then, I mean, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I wouldn't rush into pulling the slider down. For most folks, the chest strap is kind of a big deal. Moving the leg straps for many people is an even bigger deal. Everybody's a little different in what freaks them out. But I would start with that stuff. But do I'm telling you, man, hang them up. It really, really helps. It helps them deal with their fear in a very tangible way. It's not sort of you got to focus on your breathing, dude. No, I'm feeling safer because I actually did this before, 1 foot off the ground, in my rig, just carabiners through the three rings. You don't have to take the main out. You don't have to change the rig at all. It's immediately jumpable after you take take it off the harness system and rig up like a Y line or something that goes to their hip rings or that region if they don't have hip rings. And so when they flare, I like bungee cord toggles or something like that. You pull their hips forward. And you can certainly show there's a video on Mighty Networks and under any harness stuff where there's an article and shows pictures and videos and things like that that I think will be very helpful to watch. But you got to do it. There's certain things that you can describe until you're blue in the face, but until they have the experiential learning, process, they're like, oh, it feels like this, things that you couldn't put into words. And afterwards, they'll be like, oh, but it's like this. You're like, yeah. Those are the words I was looking for, but they have to feel it, keeping the knees together as they roll their harness input, right? As they, explore what do they do with their feet as they're giving harness input? Can you make it swing to side to side with some aggression just with your ass, not by pulling on stuff? Really greatly expedites the process. I mean, it speeds it up. So, but the exercises that I try to get people to start off with are in the Be Licensed and Beyond PowerPoint video that I made. Essential maneuvers is what I call that, Be Licensed and Beyond or something. But that will be a really helpful guideline for you to just, like, first of all, where are you in the system? Are the brakes too sloppy or are they too tight? Let's evaluate that. Let's evaluate the bottom end. Can I actually, a full arm extension, can I stall the canopy or not? Have a plan for if it stalls. This is not the plan, to just lift it up and stop the surge in a symmetrical way and slowly lift the hands back up. And once you've done that, to explore the value of your control input with the goal of leveling off in a variety of airspeed contexts. Right. So if I shove when I'm up here, say 6 inches, what does that feel like versus down here at 6 inches of input? This down here, 6 inches. And you'll notice down here, 6 inches isn't very valuable. You need more than 6 inches when you've already slowed down quite a lot. So to get a sense of how much is necessary to achieve level flight and focusing on the feeling of the process. The feeling of the movement of the pitch, you can really clarify by looking at the canopy, watching it move behind you. But more importantly, the feeling of weight gain, right? As you shove it to level flight, oh, a little bit heavy. To explore that is huge. And recognize that if you start a little high, kind of smooth, and then shove the brakes when it's altitude appropriate, when you get down to into the range of human body height, that will allow you to finish the job. And that doesn't necessarily require, it's not necessarily this, and it's certainly not this. It's somewhere in between, right? And I can't give you a numerical value because it's different for every circumstance. It's different based on the airspeed. It's different based on the wing loading, the canopy itself. completely changes how much is necessary. So kind of give them some guided discovery and guided exploration exercises. So guided discovery would be like, you know, that if they look at a digital altimeter and then immediately sharp flare, they can be leveled off in 6 to 8 feet of descent. You know that because all parachutes with a sharp input will level off in that amount of altitude minimum. I mean, it's very, very quick. So that's, you're giving them an experience that you kind of already know the answer to. Whereas guided exploration would be like, I want you to feel the lift as you add the brakes. And of course, you know that they're going to get lift, but you don't know how much they're going to have to add to feel that lift, right? You don't know what hand position they're going to be at when they get to level flight, because the sweet spot, the point at which the parachute levels off, is not a finite location. It's based on airspeed. It's based on configuration, right? Whether the chest strap is loose or the slider is down, you know, all that stuff. It's also based on how many brake lines are attached to the tail. That varies from one canopy to the other. What is the configuration of those brake lines? There's tons of variables. And what is the airspeed that you're carrying when you add that sharpening? And so if you give them stuff like, I want you to play around with harness and toggle turn, where you get the canopy turner and just sort of flying in a wide circle and you add the brakes and you release the brakes. And as you add the brakes, you don't push in front of you. You push down the sides of your body so that you're loading up your leg straps instead of loading up the rig with your back. You push and you get heavy, and then you lighten it up, and you push and you get heavy, and you're not stopping the turn. You're not trying to slow the yaw rate. You're trying to keep it going, not in a spiral, in a wide arcing turn, adding weight and reducing weight, adding weight and reducing weight. And it's going to help them to get to feel their canopy instead of have this mechanical flare of, I go to here and then I go to here. It's not enough information. You have to really explore the sensations of it. So there's much more to talk about with that, but I feel like we should start with getting you to watch that other video, because I've already kind of done it in a much more organized fashion, you know, with the PowerPoint. And it's based on USPA's B license exercises, but I go into a lot of explanations beyond just what's on that little card, pull on a rear riser, you know. That's not enough information. Yeah. One of the topics we got into the other night with Darlene, who's highly experienced jumper and pilot. She's been a drop zone owner forever. We were talking about the A license requirement of turn reversal and sort of debating a little bit, what is the value of it? Like, why is it even on the A license requirements to be in a turn and then go back the other way? And some believe that it is so that we can essentially make them risk line twists, or possibly give themselves line twists at high altitudes, so they realize that that's a risk. Okay, you know, let's put the bunch of, you know, toddlers in the kitchen, leave the fire on and let them learn that fire is hot. Sounds irresponsible to me. So I don't think that's what it's for. I think the reason why we put this in there is so that we can teach the timing of the relief of the input to the weight gain that happens a couple seconds later that allows you to reverse your direction. And if you do it too soon, yeah, you're going to get line twists, but I don't have to give you a certain situation where you kind of give yourself line twists for you to learn it. I just have to teach you the right way to do it. You turn, you wait a moment, you feel the weight gain, and then you reverse, because line tension is maneuvering capability. With no line tension, you've got no connection to the wing, and you can get yourself the line twists, or at least the beginning of line twists, where the canopy breaks its connection and its yaw goes a little faster than you do, and then you catch up to it. It's still not a very good feeling. And then, of course, once you get the hang of the weight and then reverse, then you can force that reversal by forcing the weight gain, right? So if you're in full flight, you go like this, you gain weight. But if you're in a turn, it's the same thing. So I'm actually in a flowy turn and I hit both brakes. Now I gain weight because of that increase in pitch angle, increase in angle of attack, increasing my lift vector, which increases my weight because they pull apart. And then because I've gained that weight, I can instantly reverse. So I can be in a turn, hit both brakes, and then reverse. And so now you can actually teach with this turn reversal, aggressive canopy maneuvering, where you tune into your canopy and you know when you can hit it hard with a maneuver and when you have to wait or at least force your line tension to increase so that you're capable of maneuvering. So I think that there is a lot of value in a turn reversal exercise, but it requires a much longer explanation. Once upon a younger year, when all our shadows disappeared, the animals inside came out to play. Went face to face with all our fears, learned our lessons through the tears, made memories we knew would never fade. One day my father, he told me, son, don't let it slip away. He took me in his arms, I heard him say, when you get older, your wild heart will live for younger days. Think of me if ever you're afraid. He said one day you'll leave this world behind, so live a life you will remember. My father told me when I was just a child, these are the nights to never die. My father told me. To those shining stars, he said, go venture far beyond the shores. Don't forsake this life of yours. I'll guide you home no matter where you are. One day my father, he told me, son, don't let it slip away. When I was just a kid, I heard him say, when you get older, your wild heart will live for younger days. Think of me if ever you're afraid. He said, one day you'll leave this world behind, so live a life. Father told me.